Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, good night, wherever you are in the world. Thank you for joining us today for our regular weekly webinars on citizenship and residency by investment. Today, the subject is St Lucia and their citizenship by investment program. My name's Edward Harris. I'm joined by Robin Thornton. We're just going to give it maybe 1 or 2 minutes. I can see the number of participants ticking up. So once that stabilizes, we will get started, but in the meantime we'll leave you with this beautiful view of St Lucia and start the actual main presentation in just a minute or so.
I think that's the Pitons, as I remember. I was there this year.
Indeed.
And that might be Marigot Bay, as I remember. And behind me actually is Rodney Bay in St Lucia. That's where I was back in there. Yeah, I did, yeah. February, March time.
We'll give it just a few more seconds to see the last few more people joining. Seems to have stabilized that now. So we'll be doing a recording of this and sending it out to anyone that either can join or is late joining. So let's get started. And if there's anybody else that joins along the way, we can add them in. So as I mentioned, today we're going to go through the St Lucia Citizenship by Investment Program, but we'll start off by giving you the quick 1 minute overview about who I am, who Robin is, and who Holborn Assets are, who we work for, and say, take you through the St Lucia program, pros, cons, features, how it works, and obviously the costs of that along the way as well. Then at the end, if we have some time, we're going to try and keep this down to around sort of 20, 25 minutes. If we have time at the end, we'll do a quick Q&A. We did get a list of sort of a couple of dozen questions that came in when people registered, so we'll try and get through those as well. So as I mentioned at the start, initially Holborn Assets. So Robin and I both work for Holborn. We are a international wealth management firm. We've been around for about 25 years. It's a family-owned firm. We look after about $2 billion of client money. We have a large number of offices dotted around the world. I'm based in Portugal. Robin's based in Spain. I used to run our Hong Kong office. Robin used to be in Dubai, in the UAE. But yes, we have offices across Africa, Europe, Asia as well. Holborn Pass is the division of Holborn that we set up about 5 years ago to focus on citizenship and residency by investment. We've had a great deal of success. Our particular focus for the last couple of years has been on the Portugal Golden Visa program. That's been incredibly popular with people around the world. But actually, there's about 22 different programs that we offer. And of those, obviously the Caribbean passports and St Lucia is the most popular of those. In terms of why work with Holborn, yes, we are specialists in citizenship and residency by investment, but coming from a wealth management background, we also have a great deal of experience of dealing with internationally mobile expatriate people on not just citizenship, but a lot of the related things that come with it, to do with working with governments, working with lawyers, real estate companies, tax planning, financial planning. So that's actually a wide range of things that we can help with over and above just the citizenship itself. Robin introduced himself in a second, but I'm Edward Harris, as I mentioned. So I'm a managing partner at Holborn Assets. I run the US investment advisory firm business for them, as well as working on the citizenship by investment side. I am qualified and registered with the SEC in the USA. Also through my sort of experience living on the ground, dealing with expatriates internationally in Hong Kong, as I mentioned, and being in Portugal, there are other areas in particular where I tend to focus. And Robin, you want to give a quick 10 seconds on yourself?
Yeah, no, thanks for that. Yeah, and myself, I'm a chartered UK financial planner. I, like it says, I live in Sotogrande in Spain, so I deal a lot with cross-border tax planning issues, mobility, investment. You know, it's quite a mixed bag. And likewise, I work quite closely with Edward, you know, on the citizenship side as well as the investment side. Do you want me to take this one, Edward?
Yes, yeah, you start off with this, Robin.
Yeah, okay. So let me just run through a little bit about, for example, CARICOM and, you know, Caribbean citizenship for those of you that are perhaps not aware, you know, even where, for example, St. Lucia is. I've had a few client calls recently, which is not unusual. It's a small, small but beautiful island in, you know, in the Caribbean. But there's some significant benefits. And actually, even in putting this presentation together, it's reaffirmed the fact that there's some very good benefits on this program, which really make it quite a compelling case of why people should go this route. And let me explain some of those. So first of all, you've got, you know, visa-free travel, 140 countries, that's all the Schengen area as well in Europe, you know, Hong Kong, UK, Singapore. So people that, you know, perhaps sometimes struggle to travel, that's a real major plus. Obviously, that's saving you money, time, hassle, you know, once you've got your St. Lucian passport. You know, it's a major benefit. It also gives you that kind of plan B. I have quite a few people come to me and say, you know, I need this in case, or perhaps in the future, with everything that's gone on in, you know, in UK, Ukraine and Russia, you know, with Brexit, with COVID, you know, people being unable to travel, locked down in, you know, Thailand for years on end. So there's a lot of different reasons, shall we say, for Plan B, and they're all kind of bespoke to the individual. So CARICOM and the Organization of Eastern Caribbean have got, it's basically like the European Union of the Caribbean. So people can move freely around the islands, they can trade freely, there's no tariffs, there's no taxation. So it's a development or a number of countries that have come together to increase their trade, tourism, and obviously wealth in the region. Great place to retire. Yeah, I'd love to retire. In fact, when I was over there in February, I met quite a few retirees who were on their yachts and boats. I don't know what the difference between a yacht and a boat is, but it was all very nice. And they were just chilling out, you know, kind of eating fried fish on the beach, you know, as if there wasn't a worry in the world. Obviously the reasons for doing that is, you know, your money goes a little bit further. So it's a very low tax jurisdiction. And we'll come on to some of the tax issues a bit later on. You know, for example, there are a number of taxes that don't apply once you are a tax resident there.
Yeah. I think that pulling a couple of those bits together, you know, you can definitely see sort of two, when we speak to people, two main driving forces behind people looking at the Caribbean versus a Portugal or a Malta or Greece or some of these other places around the world or the US. And one is that that plan B, that planting a flag somewhere, giving yourself that option against, you know, turmoil or whatever else might be going on in the world, and doing it in a jurisdiction which isn't going to bring with it associated sort of complications from a tax point of view, which a lot of those other options that I mentioned do. And then the other one is that, you know, we get a lot of clients around the world who, and sometimes, you know, having a British passport would take it for advantage, but there are, you know, really large numbers of passports around the world where you just can't get on a plane and go somewhere. It is a much more complicated, time-consuming, expensive process. And that affects their lives, it affects their business options, and indeed sometimes business prospects, because they can't get on a plane and go and see a customer or check a factory or so on. And they have, you know, real long-term costs for people. So I think we tend to have those sort of two different sort of types of reasons why people are looking at the Caribbean versus some of the other options that are out there.
Yep. Just a little bit about St. Lucia again, for those that are not familiar with it. As you can see from the map there, it's pretty close to Antigua and obviously Dominica. You've got Cuba and the US, so there's quite good flight connections. You find actually in St. Lucia, because it's got a international airport in the south called Hawanora. So you get international connections there a lot from the US, direct flights from the UK, for example, as well, into St. Lucia. It's a pretty well-developed country. Eastern Caribbean dollars is the currency, which, as I recall, is about 3.5, I think it is, to the US dollar. English is the official language of the country, with a little bit of mix of patois, which is a kind of a French dialect. Bit of history: the English and the French fought over St. Lucia, I think, for about 100 years. And in some instances, it changed hands, each year for 5 years. So you get a big French influence there as well in the heritage, which is nice because you get a real blend of the different cultures. And an interesting point, actually, which is not talked about, is it does have a parliamentary democracy. It's part of the Commonwealth. And it still has a constitutional monarchy, which obviously now is the king. So the program, this is a lovely picture of Marigot Bay as well. So the program has been going since 2015. It, as we said before, it gives you access to a whole host of countries. It's fast processing. It says here 3 to 6 months. We always like to be a little bit conservative. I would suggest that it's probably 5 to 6 months. You never know, holidays, volume of applications, etc. We've got two, I think, real important things, or real key drivers for people here that are thinking about this program. One is you can add your children or dependent children under the age of 30. Now, they just need to be dependent on you. So they're studying or they're doing some kind of program. And also your parents over the age of 55, which is quite young. So I think in Portugal, it's 65, as I recall. Now, it's also irrevocable. So once you get your passport, it's a generational thing. You can pass that down to, actually, you could be passing it down to unborn children as well. And key to this is there are no travel requirements. So you don't actually have to visit St. Lucia, which is a bit unusual. Again, compare that to other programs. Portugal, you have to visit for 5 weeks in 5 years. There's a cost to that. There's a, especially you have a family. Whereas St. Lucia, you don't actually have to do that. Obviously, the government encourages you and wants you to, get involved in some of the culture. And it's a beautiful place, as you can see over my shoulder, to visit. So there's plenty of reasons to go there. So some of the other benefits, we're not necessarily going to go through all of them here, but it's a beautiful place to visit, it was said. It's the only rainforest in the Caribbean, in the middle of the island. Clearly, you've got plenty of rum distilleries, which I've visited. It's a lovely place to go. Rodney Bay in the north is where all the tourists are. Some amazing hotels, bars, and restaurants. Ed talked about there earlier some people who, what their drivers are for doing this. So one big thing here is tax. Now, we're not tax advisors. We can introduce people to it, but there are, no capital gains tax, no acquisition tax, no inheritance tax. There's no wealth tax. I'm here in Spain. There's a wealth tax. If you've got a, significant net wealth, you pay extra taxes. And there's no tax on your worldwide income either. So there are some real fundamental, okay, this is starting to sound pretty good. On top of that, you've got infrastructure. And you've got, good access to, markets, global markets like the US, for example, and internet access. It's a proven route to citizenship. Again, you know, we've got clients that have gone through this, they've done that, they've got their passport, so there's no waiting 4 or 5 years, 6 years. What happens if the parliament changes or the political balance changes? None of that whatsoever. And like we said before, it's pretty quick and efficient processing. This is how it works in terms of the application process, some pre-screening, which we do for our clients as well. Make sure that you've got a clean history. You know, you're not an international gun runner or something like that. We prepare all the application for you. Basically, we do the whole process for you with our partners in St. Lucia, because we have to have an agent on the ground in St. Lucia. The application is submitted. The government department then does their kind of due diligence checks as well. So they'll be checking your history, your passport, you know, anything that needs verifying. And then you get your approval, dependent on what route you've gone. And then quite simply, you get your passport delivered or passports for your family. So it really is pretty efficient and quick. So how can you do it? There are effectively three routes to citizenship in St. Lucia. The one is a donation to the National Economic Fund. And it is a donation. You're writing a check. You're not going to see that money back. Single applicant, 100,000 US. Main applicant plus spouse, 140. And then you have a couple of family members, 150,000. It's clear, clean, and quick. No questions. The second is the real estate option, which is quite popular. Now, that goes from 200,000. However, you're getting an investment with that, so you're going to get a return on that. And we can discuss that option with clients individually, how best to do that, and how you're going to basically return some of that capital to you quite quickly, so that you don't have to shell out 200,000 in one go. So it can be the most cost-effective option, but we have to discuss that with you on an individual basis. And then the third option is to buy a government bond. I'm not sure St. Lucian government bonds, how they trade. I guess they trade in US dollars, but it's a five-year bond. You get no interest at all. So you've probably got 5 years, of say 5% inflation that you've lost on that. And you've got your fees, et cetera, on top. So 50,000 government fee on top, plus one or two other bits and pieces as well. So this is a summary of the three options. Donation route, family of four, 150,000. Real estate, government fees, 200, 220, 240. But like I said, there are ways to structure that in a different way. So at least you're buying something that you're getting a return on. So your net investment will be a lot stronger. And then you've got the routes for the government bond.
Yeah, I think as Robin was alluding to, the real estate option often ends up, when we look at the sort of arrangements that are possible, the real estate option tends to work out to actually be the most cost efficient. But with the various different costs and fees and taxes involved, you still have to assume that this is going to end up costing you between 100 and 120, depending on the size of your family, $1,000 US. So whichever route you go down, you've got to assume that is going to be your sunk cost for having done this and getting the benefit of getting a passport for yourself and your family that then you can pass down through generations.
Yeah, it's actually really it's a great program, isn't it? If you think, especially if somebody's, maybe looking to improve their passport, it's very, very good. So who's it suitable for? We do a lot of work with clients you know, doing identifying what's suitable for them. You know, everything is bespoke. Everyone's got a different perspective on things and different family situation. So this is kind of suitable for people who perhaps have got a weak passport. Not being derogatory there, but there are some passports around the world where it's really difficult to travel. You know, you can't just jump on a plane and arrive in Spain, for example, or into the US. It is difficult. Fully aware of some people who struggle with that, and it does affect the family, and it does affect their businesses. I've got a couple of clients personally who were, you know, really struggle to get into the European Union to do business. As we said before, it gives you that kind of plan B. Who's that open for? Pretty much most people, I would suggest, except for perhaps EU citizens, but even British nationals, you know, since Brexit, that's caused problems for them as well. You know,
also had other a European nations. This week with a gentleman with an American passport who has been a long-term expat. If you have an American passport, you have to pay worldwide taxation. No matter where you live in the world, and he was considering in his retirement, did he want to carry on drawing his pension, everything else, carry on paying tax in the US, no plans to ever go back and live in the US, but needs to get rid of his US passport and therefore needs an alternative passport to have. So yeah, you know, we sometimes in our heads, we think about, you know, who this might appeal to, but sometimes it can be people who actually also still have strong passports, but there are other complications that those passports bring.
Yep. Yeah, absolutely. And there's the next one, number three, tax. Those who are considering the tax implications. So there's no real language restrictions as well. That's pretty good, I think, for client suitability. Sometimes perhaps you come across people who don't want to learn a second or third language. Perhaps they're getting to my age and they're going to struggle learning, you know, Portuguese, for example, to get a passport.
Yeah, and then bringing the language together with the costs, whether it's the Portuguese program or the Greek program or so on, all of these programs still require, you have to make some sort of investment at some point in time. And whether it's through government fees, legal fees, the tying up of, generally speaking, a lot more capital over a long period of time and the opportunity cost of having done so, sometimes... Yep. If you add up all those different things and the barriers, yes, you've got to pass a language test for Portugal, you have to pass a language test for Spain citizenship, you have to pass a language test for Greek citizenship. So A, there's time and effort to be put into that, cost of having language lessons and so on. So, you know, and those programs all cost a lot more money. So actually, you know, when you weigh up all those things, it is tremendous value that literally for, you know, a one-off payment, within a few months, you just get the passport straight through. It is quite a unique opportunity.
Yeah, no, it is, absolutely. No need to visit. I think we touched on that before, but that can be, again, one of those hidden costs and extra costs. You know, if you're a Middle Eastern client and you're having to travel to Portugal, family of four, you're probably looking at, you know, $3,000 or $4,000 just in flights, and then you've got accommodation and et cetera. So that can really add up. And you've got to do that for, you know, 5 weeks over 5 years. And that's it, really. Got any questions, Ed, that have come in on that pre-registration that we can maybe run through?
Yeah. So quite a few of them related to some of the things that we did mention on the webinar, but I was kind of, we draw attention to them. One is, how long does it take? So generally speaking, if you speak to the agents, they'll say it's 3 to 4 months. We tend to add a couple of months on top just to make sure, but really that tends to really just depend on the client. How fast does the client get the information to us that is required? You know, have you done your background checks, sending us copies of your passports, those types of things. So that tends to be the sort of main factor there. Is there any age limit? There's no upper age limit in terms of how old the main applicant can be. Scrolling through these, some of these are similar sort of questions. About asking about children. So as Robin mentioned, so it's children, dependent children, 30 and below, and dependency is yes, they either have to be studying or, you know, demonstrate that you pay them some money every month, a little support or something. And also, yes, you can also include dependent parents, 55 and above. How much is the investment? I think we just touched on that. A few people are saying, you know, they're from a certain nationality. Are they able to qualify? And generally speaking, for St Lucia, it's open to almost every nationality, with just a handful of exceptions, which would be at the moment Russia is suspended, North Korea. It's only 10 to be countries where there's sort of international sanctions on those particular countries. But generally speaking, there's a few people from different African countries here asking, and the answer for all those has been yes. Yes, there'll be no restriction there.
Yeah. Okay.
Again, age limits for children. So yeah, sort of broadly similar. Then people asking very specific questions about the investments, the types of properties, and so on. And as Robin said, really, that's something that, you know, we're not looking to go through today. It's already been sort of 26 minutes, and that is something that we need to go through one on one. Explain how the investment mechanism works and why, in most cases, that's the most efficient way of doing it in terms of total cost of ownership, cost of getting the passport, and all added together, the fees, the taxes, and so on. That tends to be the best way, but that is something that's best gone through one-on-one. And on screen, obviously, you've got Robin's details and my details. So the best thing to do is to drop us a line, and we can fix up a time wherever you are in the world to have a conversation with you and understand more about your situation. See if St Lucia is the best fit for you. As I mentioned, we don't just do St Lucia. We do about 20 different programs, including a whole host of other Caribbean programs. In some cases, they are more suitable for people than St Lucia is, but also, you know, the EB5, EB3 programs in the US, all the EU programs that are being run, UAE, Native Emirates, visas as well. So we have a sort of full range of stuff that we can talk about clients and ensure that and we understand what it is you're trying to achieve and help find the program that suits you best. To that end, again, on screen is details of the next couple of webinars that we're doing. Next one, Robin is doing on Spain and buying property in Spain as part of the Golden Visa program there. And then the following week, myself, Robin, and another colleague of ours, Tyrone Siren, will be talking about the EB3 US immigration program.
Good. So is that anything else, I think?
I think that will do for today. So in which case, thank you for joining us. For those that couldn't make it live, we'll make sure you get a copy of this on YouTube. So if you're watching that now, again, I hope you enjoyed it. And yeah, we'll look forward to hearing from you soon.
That's brilliant. Thanks. Have a good evening. Take care.
Bye-bye.